What do you want? Leave us alone.
Hey guys, it's Jeff Lafferty. It's the Artcast. Let's do some work. So I'm working on some thumbnails. And as you guys, a few of you guys have already guessed on Instagram, these are comic book pages. So yeah, I am actually working on the second issue of the Berserkernaut. And I know I was kind of on the fence, or pretty much had decided that I wasn't going to finish up the comic. But hey, you know, I've changed my mind again. I'm gonna go ahead and do it. And I don't know, I'll talk to you guys more about that later. I want to talk a little bit about thumbnails though, because I've been getting a lot of questions about my process, how I write and plot out an episode of a comic. And you know, since I'm thumbnailing right now, it's the perfect time to talk about it, because I got all this stuff out and right in front of me and that kind of stuff. Let me talk a little bit about writing. I write in what's called the Marvel method. And the reason I do that is because some of you guys know, I guess maybe some of you guys don't, but I used to work at Marvel. I worked on a bunch of comics for them a long time ago, way back in the 90s. And a lot of the writers at that time were still using what's called the Marvel method. And what is that? That's where you don't get a full script. You get an outline. And so the outline can be very sort of finished out, or it can be pretty loose still, with some of the dialogue missing, some of the conversations missing, some of the action. Instead of like telling you, you know, the Thing picks up the Hulk and throws him through a wall, it's just like the Thing and the Hulk battle. You know what I mean? Let them battle for 2 pages and get on to the next thing. Anyway, that whole Marvel method came from the days of Jack Kirby and Stan Lee and Steve Ditko and all those guys, and them having to crank those comics out quickly. You know, they didn't have time to write full scripts. You know, they didn't have enough artists and they didn't have enough writers, and so they were going fast. And so fast to them meant outlining out a story, giving that to the artist. The artist would draw the story, give it back to, you know, Stan, and he would write the dialogue. And even though it was kind of like a method that was sort of, you know, born out of like necessity and speed, I've met a lot of guys, a lot of like big time heavy hitter comic guys that really believe, and I'm actually one of them, not a heavy hitter, but I'm one of the guys who believes this, that the Marvel method of writing is a superior way of writing. Because I feel like when you write a full script, you lay too much of the responsibility of the book on the writer, and you take it away from the person who, in my opinion, should have the brunt of the responsibility, and that's the artist. Because comics are about visual storytelling, and if the writer isn't an artist, and especially if he isn't a comic book artist, he probably doesn't really understand, you know, visual storytelling. But a good comic book artist does. He knows how to tell a story with pictures. So in that aspect, I think it's like, why would you take that away from the artist? He's like the one who actually knows how to do storytelling. So like, give him the storytelling reins, and let the writer think about, you know, the plot and the dialogue and all that kind of stuff. I remember I was out in San Diego. I was at the Eisner Awards, and I was a young artist, sort of like starstruck by everybody who was there. And I overheard a conversation. And it was Will Eisner, Al Williamson, and a few other guys. I mean, there was sort of almost like a crowd of them, like about 8 to 10 guys, and like almost every one of them was like somebody you knew. And they were talking about writing, and there was somebody in there that kind of made a joke about, you know, that Marvel method of writing, like it's not writing, like they, you know, like they need real writers in comics. And I was really surprised, because Will Eisner and oh, actually, Kubert was in there too. That's the other guy I was thinking about, Joe Kubert. They just immediately got on this guy, and they're like, "No, no, no! You know, it's not that way. The Marvel method is like what kind of freed comics, and made them good because it, like I said, it laid a lot of the storytelling on the artists, like the guys who actually, you know what looks cool. You know, and I've always like remembered that, and I've always like thought about it, and." It really makes sense because when Marvel showed up with their version of comics in the 60s, you know, I mean, it was a definite shift in just not only like the style of what they were doing, which was, you know, coming on strong with superheroes. But that wasn't completely new. There was, you know, Batman and Superman, and, you know, there was a lot of superheroes long before the 60s and like the Fantastic Four and Spider-Man. But like the style of storytelling definitely changed at that point, and it got like a lot more sort of dynamic, you know. Anyway, I'm kind of drifting off the point, but I write in this Marvel method, and I love it because I really like to just kind of focus on plot, focus on where things happen. I guess I've heard people talk about like the beats of the story, and I guess that's like a good way of talking about it, where you're writing like the main events, the boom, boom, boom. And I also always write backwards. And I came across this piece of advice in my younger days. And it was from Mickey Spillane. And that's what he said. He's just like, always write from the end. Because you ever went to a movie and like the end is the worst scene in the movie? And we all have. And what a bummer that is. And he's like, the guys who wrote those movies, they write the first scene first, because you always write the best scene first. And what I love about that sort of method, the stories almost kind of write themselves by answering the questions of like why this is happening. You know, I don't want to tell you the last scene of the Berserk or not, but if you just jumped in and you didn't know what the hell was going on and you just saw what was happening, you'd have a bunch of questions. And it's like once you start to answer those questions and explain how this all happened, that becomes like your plot. So anyway, once I got my plot and all that, now let me show you this. I start out sketching very loosely in my notebooks, and here they are. They're just like the lined notebooks. And like the first pass, I'm not precious about it, and I don't think about pages. I just draw like panels, I guess you could say, draw moments. And I just go through the story and I draw like a quick sketch, as you guys can see here, and I just go moment to moment. So like here, let me show you some of these. Right here, the Berserkernaut jumps out a window, he lands on a roof, he like stands up and looks around. He can see, you know, in the distance, the guy that he's chasing like cutting across the rooftops, and there's like a close-up of his eyes, you know, I got you now, you son of a bitch, and then like a helicopter spotlight's like hitting him. And I just draw those things kind of like randomly in my sketchbook, and I just kind of go moment by moment by moment through the whole story. Now, like I said, I don't always have the story 100% in my head at that point. You know what I mean? It's still open. It's still just an outline. So a lot of the action scenes and stuff, I'm just working out in my sketchbook, you know? And I go off on tangents that I'm like, oh, this isn't working, and I'll go back and I'll do something different. But what I like about this is it gives me a chance to think about what's going to look cool, you know, what's going to look neat, and what's going to be sort of engaging and fun for the audience to kind of follow along with, you know. Right here is a great example of why I love the Marvel method, because, like, it really plays to the visual. It plays to the artist. And even though I'm the writer and the artist, I want the artist part of me handling the storytelling. And so then, like, once I have sort of like a run of these kind of single panel type situations going on, these single panel sketches, then I start thinking about page layout. You know, page layout, super important for comics, right? And that's when I do a little bit tighter sketches. I still do it in the same sketchbook, but a lot of times I'll actually get another sketchbook so I can have like my pages of sketches open on one side and then a page open to what I'm sketching out. And this is what these things look like. They're a little less rough. You know, now I'm sort of thinking about what's actually in the panel and what they're kind of look like. But the main thing I'm thinking about is how spatially they're going to work, you know? And a lot of them I'll sketch like multiple times. Like this one, let's see, I guess it's page 10. As you can see, there's like, there's three, I think. There's this one, this little shrimpy panel is actually page 10. I'll show you this whole thing. It's like the first one is this, then you got the shrimpy one. And with this one, I had him kind of coming out the window. I don't know if you guys can even tell what's going on there, but he's coming out the window. And that panel is like across the top. And then I did this one down here, which is, you know, it's just like a long, like three panel thing. So you got a long shot on the first panel, then you got the top panel, and you got the landing shot. And when I finally ended up doing page 10, let me show you. It came out like this. So like that one there is actually the one I went with. And so here's the more finished sketch. And you can see he's jumping out the window, he lands, and then he kind of stands up and he's like, where's he at? You know, and I just drew that little where to kind of remind myself of what he's saying. Anyway, once I got a bunch of geese things sketched out, then I go to the note cards. And I love this system because I draw a whole bunch of note cards. And as you guys can see, I got like 20 up here on my desk, taped down right now. And I just keep drawing until I get the first issue done. I just keep drawing, keep drawing, and keep drawing. And anything I get to that doesn't work, I throw it away and I redraw it. So once I get, you know, all of these done, like I get 24 of these done, like a 24-page comic, or actually this next issue of the Berserker Knot, it's going to be a little bit longer just because I want it to end at a cool spot where, you know, not necessarily a cliffhanger, but just something where you want to turn the page and keep reading, you know. Once I get these things drawn, I do this here, which this is actually from the first issue of the Berserker Knot. See, I tape them all into this little mini comic book. And as you can see, I got the cover there, which became the cover of my comic. And then here's some pages. And they're just the note cards taped into a little book that I just made out of, you know, paper, and I just stapled it together. It's just like a little mini comic. And what's awesome about this, now, when you get to this point, what I love about this, you can really see how the pages like work together, especially if you're doing what's called a full bleed. And a full bleed means that your art is running completely off the page. There's no border or margin around your art, so the art runs completely off the page, which is, you know, the way most, you know, modern comics do it, and it's the way I like to do it. I think it looks cooler that way. But it's also kind of tricky because when you're designing panels, you're designing them separate. But then when you put the pages together, those two separate design elements have to work together as a single design element because you have the pages open and you're looking at both pages at the same time. So if you have some weird panel that's almost connecting with another panel, it might look like, you know, your eye is supposed to travel onto the other page, or some weird thing like that can happen. And that's what's really cool about when you tape these together into a book, because it becomes very apparent as to how the panels are going to work together. And that's it. That's how I do comics. And this is even how I used to do it back in the 90s. You know, even though I wasn't a writer back then, I was a penciler, but, you know, I found it very helpful to just make little books, make little sketches, and put them together like this. All right, so I wanted to say one more thing about this method I have of doing, you know, the sketches. And even though I think this is a great method, and this really helps me, let me get the camera a little more on me, but this really helps me, you know, do my stuff. You know, it's a great crutch for like those days when you're like, I don't know if, you know, I don't know if this is working. I have all these doubts. I'm not sure. I'm feeling down in the dumps, and or whatever your, you know, problem is that you can't get your comics done. It's a great way, because you can always just open this up and go like, I need to draw that panel. That's all I got to do. I just got to draw that one. And then tomorrow, all I got to do is do this one. That's it. It works great for that kind of thing. But there's the kind of guy who, doing something like this, will stop them, you know. And it's the kind of guy, or the kind of artist, kind of comic book artist that I talk about a lot, because I see it like all over the place. I see it with a lot of young artists. I see it with a lot of older artists. I just see it everywhere, you know what I mean? And that's the kind of artist who has got themselves tied into such a knot over perfection, or maybe not even perfection, but just the way they want to do their stuff, that doing something like this, or writing a script even, is like a 10-year project, you know? If it's going to take you 10 years to do the script, don't write the script. I mean, I know that's probably like, oh, don't, Jeff, what are you doing? Don't tell people that. But seriously, you know, it's like, if you're going to work yourself into a knot over writing a script, then just throw the script out and just start working on a comic. And also this, if it's going to kill you, if you're going to work on this thing for 10 years, and you're going to be sketching, and everything's got to be perfect, and I'm going to rewrite it 15,000 times, then don't do it. Then don't do it. Paint the first, or draw. You know, I'm the only one painting. Or there's a couple other guys. I didn't mean to exclude, you know, some of my friends that also are crazy enough to paint comics. But then don't sketch it out. Just paint your first panel tomorrow. And then the next day, paint your next panel. And then the next day, paint your next panel. And your comic will get done through that process. You know what I'm saying? Make that your goal. Because that's the main thing. It's like all of the tools. And it kind of drives me crazy, because I see a lot of guys talking about comics or animation or a lot of different things. And they throw out all these rules that are supposed to be like, well, you need to do it this way. You got to do it this way, or it won't get done right. But the truth is, if you can't do it by the rules, you know, if it's too much of a problem to do it that way, then don't do it by the rules. You know what I mean? The point is to get your comic done, not to impress Joe Blow on the internet that thinks it should be done this way. You know what I'm saying? The point is to get your comic done. So, you know, if my method, you know, of thumbnailing out stuff helps you get your comic done, then do it that way. But if it doesn't, still do your comic. You know, still do it. Don't get all worked up like this is the way that you got to do it and all that stuff. I hate seeing that. I hate it, you know. And I've got a little bit of it in me. That's why I rail against it so often. You know what I mean? That's why I talk about it a lot, because, you know, I'm a perfectionist. You know, that's how you get good at art. You spend like the first 20 years of your life, you know, sort of building up the walls of perfection that make your art good. And then I think at some point you just have to start busting some holes in those walls so that you can actually get stuff going, you know, get stuff done, get your stuff out there that you've spent your whole life preparing to do and have not done yet. That's it, guys. I hope that helps somebody out there. I don't know. Like I said, I'm actually working on the second issue of the Berserkernaut. I'm still going to be doing the animation. I'm not going to... I'll just talk about all this in another video, but I am going to finish up the episode of animation that I'm doing. I'm working on that. That'll be done, you know, a couple months. And anyway, I'll talk about that. You know, I'll talk more about my plans with the animation and all that kind of stuff. But for now, it's just like, you know, I'm back on the comics. So that's it. I'll see you guys next time.